It's 89.9 KCRW and morning becomes eclectic. Back at the end of June, Paul McCartney was in Los Angeles. He played an in-store at Amoeba Records. We've got some songs from that set coming up, as well as a conversation we had with him backstage. But first up, it's the music. Sir Paul McCartney, live at Amoeba on Morning Becomes Eclectic. You're listening to a live set of music. It's Sir Paul McCartney on Morning Becomes Eclectic.
Hey, 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 calm down. Hey, welcome to Amoeba. Got to be the most surreal gig ever. And the management has asked us to point out, no shoplifting, please.
You're listening to a set of music recorded live at Amoeba Records in Hollywood with Paul McCartney.
I love you! Well done. We're having a good time. Okay. That was me at the scout camp in the school play, spade and bucket by the sea. That was me. That was me playing conkers at the bus stop on a blanket in the bluebells. That was me. The same me that stands here now when I think that all that stuff to make a life is pretty hard to take it in. That was me. Well, that was me, Royal Iris on the river, Mersey beating with the band. Yeah, that was me. That was me, sweating cobwebs on the contract in a cellar on TV. That was me. Save me to stand here now. If fate agrees at all of this, I'll make a lifetime. Who am I to disagree? Oh, that was me.
This morning becomes eclectic at 89.9 KCRW, listening to a live set of music recorded at the Amoeba Record Store in Hollywood back at the end of June with Paul McCartney. We grabbed him backstage before the set and asked him a couple of questions, and my first question was the one that he gets asked all the time. How does he feel about playing the Beatles songs?
Well, yeah, I can see what they mean, because it's like, you know, I could just sort of say, well, I feel good, I think they're good songs. But I think what they're getting at is that the sort of memories behind it, you know, when you hear something just comes on the radio, you go, whoa, it takes you right back, you know, most of the time to Abbey Road with the guys. And just because it's become, like, so famous, you know, we just made them as little records.
Right.
We're just trying to make hits like anyone was, you know. But a lot of it's become so famous that it's got so much attached to it. And so it is kind of quite exciting for me to hear a Beatle record, because it just takes me right back to the studio. I can see John standing there, see George picking up his guitar, tuning it, and, you know, Ringo banging away and me thumping away on the bass. And it's very special, you know, because we don't do it anymore, because two of the guys aren't here. So, you know, listening to a Beatle record is special for me.
It's interesting, though, because you've obviously written so many more songs since you were in the Beatles than you did in the time you were in the Beatles, obviously with your early part of your solo career and then Wings, and then just a stack of records, really. Do you still get a kick out of writing songs? Do you have to discipline yourself to write songs?
No, I'm very lucky, actually. It's like, it's my hobby, you know. So I just do it whenever I've got some time, I thought that idea of I should like nail myself down and okay, it's Monday morning. It's 11 o'clock.
Time to start.
Time to write, you know, go and write. But it doesn't happen like that with me. It's more a question of, oh, you know, wait a minute, I'm doing nothing. I've got some time. I don't have to be there. So I sit down at the piano, or mainly with a guitar, and just, it's the same old magic, you know. It's like there's this black hole in space in, right in front of my eyes, and it's like, I wonder if there's a song in there. Let's see. You know, and then you just start playing a little bit, whatever comes to mind on guitar. And you just start trying to craft something. And like I say, you know, touch wood, you know, I'm pretty lucky, because something comes out and then I follow that trail and try and craft it, you know, with the things I've learned over the years. So it's very exciting. I always say, you know, if people just said to me, right, we don't want your records, you know, nobody wants to put them out, we don't want you writing anymore, I'd do it anyway. They're not going to stop me, you know, because it's my hobby.
Well, it's great that your hobby is obviously, you know, something that you can still go out and enjoy and take your band out and play these songs as well. I know that in recent years you've taken a number of bands out. You've done a number of solo tours, obviously. You still mix Beatles material into the sets because everybody wants
to
hear it.
Yeah, you know, there was a point right after the Beatles broke up and I started Wings that I kind of just said, I'm not going to do Beatles stuff, because I was trying to establish something new in Wings, and I thought, you know, that's the last thing I need, is, you know, everyone going, oh, God, Paul, sing Yesterday.
Yeah.
You know, wait a minute, no, I've got to do this Wings song. So I just kind of, you know, made a rule, we don't do Beatles stuff. And
when did you change it?
We did that for a little while, but then I just thought, you know what, we've now established Wings, and people were kind of excited to hear the Wings stuff. And that's what's happening now, particularly when I go out on tour now. There's a lot of people who say, you know, you should have done more Wings stuff, man, because it's a generational thing. A lot of people grew up and they remember that period fondly. I was talking to some guy a number of years ago, and I was saying, well, of course, you know, Sergeant Pepper, that was the era. He said, well, it wasn't for me, man. He said, it was more Band on the Run for me. And I suddenly realized, wow, you know, It's a
different generation, and those people were hearing Band on the Run and Venus and Mars on the radio.
Yeah,
I guess.
Exactly. So I just thought, you know, that's, we've established that fact that Wings is cool. You know, I did Wings. So now we can just, I can do anything. So now I just go rummage in the old, you know, record box, find like B-sides of Beatle things. Last time we went out, we were doing this thing called I Get You. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That was real, like, you know, vintage Beatles stuff. But it all seems to hang together.
Well, let's talk about this record, obviously. You actually put a record out just about 2 years ago as well, right? I think you did one with Nigel Godrich, is that right?
Yeah.
But I'm led to believe that the songs on this were actually recorded before that.
Yeah, a few of these were started in 2003, before I started work on my last album, which was Chaos and Creation, to back out. And then I broke off this one, the Memory Almost Full album, after me and the band had done about, about eight or so tracks in Abbey Road. We were starting an album. Then the opportunity came up. Nigel had some time, and I wanted to work with him. He wanted to work with me. So I kind of postponed this record, went off, worked with him, and then came back to this and thought, well, we'll see. You know, it may not be any good. I may not like these tracks. But as I looked at each one, I thought, well, that's okay. So a little bit of fixing to be done. So I kind of learned something in the intervening time. So I changed a couple of drum sounds, redid a few little things, wrote some new stuff. Suddenly I found I had a new album. It kind of took me by surprise.
What do you find to write about now? I mean, do you still write about what's going on around you?
Well, you know, you listen to the record. It's like I write about anything that kind of comes into my mind. I think on this record, Memory Almost Full, the opening track is just a feel-good dance song. Everybody gonna dance tonight, you know. And that just came about because I bought a new mandolin, and over last Christmas, I was playing it in the kitchen, plonking away and stomping my foot, and my little 3.5-year-old came running in. She's dancing like they do, you know. And I just said, wow, I love this song. So that was just a dance, feel-good song. And then some of the others are just made up. There's one called Mr. Bellamy, which is just a completely fictionalized account of some guy I don't know. It's just some guy who's, is he going to jump off the skyscraper or isn't he? So that's like a little mini film, like a short story. And there's one called Mama Only Knows, which is, it's about some kid who was abandoned. Again, that's just fiction. So the story just sort of came to me, so I just kind of wrote it like it was a short story. And then there are some that are more personal. There's one that quite a few of my friends have singled out, but nobody in radio or anyone's noticed it yet. It's called You Tell Me. Right. And it's just about, I don't know, it's like, I think it's about the fourth track. And it's kind of a nice little song, you know. But some people who I really respect have said, that's the best song you've written in a long while. In fact, one of my friends, Dave Gilmore of Pink Floyd,
sure.
Dave has learned it.
Well, he's played on the road with you before.
He's
right?
played, yeah. I mean, but yeah, he has. We've done stuff to.
So he's learned it because he wants to come and play.
No, he's just learned it like to play at home
because he likes it.
I just happened to see him at a party the other night, my birthday party, and he just said, "I love that song, man." So you know, that's much more personal, and it's about kind of golden summers, and it's kind of a mystical little song there. But I like that one a lot.
Very quickly, this record, you put it out in a bit of a different way from how records have come out in the past.
Yeah, you know, I was talking to my producer, David Kahn, and what we realized was that when we talked to the major record companies, they were in a little bit of a state because of the downloading, because of iTunes, because of the internet, and because of all the new ways records are getting sold now. It isn't just the traditional old record shop anymore. In fact, far from it. They're kind of, you know, beautiful, but there's not as many of them. I mean, the minute Tower Records closed, that was like end of an era, you know? So I just said, well, I kind of feel that the major record labels, my label, EMI, was not really going to know what to do with the record. So I said, we've got to help them. We've got to think of some things to do. And it actually ended up with me going with Starbucks because they came up. I knew a guy who knew a guy. David knew this guy called Alan Mintz. Alan came round, and he's a bass player. He's a fan of mine. And he, like, loved the record. And he's saying, you know, we would like to put it out through Starbucks. And I said, well, that's an interesting idea. And then they started to, you know, remind me how many stores they had, 400 in China alone.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going, you know what? This could be a very interesting thing to do. So we went with them. And the amount of people now I meet who said, oh, I picked up your record. I was in Starbucks. It's just a very interesting thing. Because what was happening was that people were saying to me, oh, I was in Best Buy, was in Walgreens, and that's where they were picking up the records. I think my last album sold most in stores like that, you know, and people just pick it up like they pick up TV Guide, pick up a couple of records.
Well, it's sitting there at the cash register, right in front of you,
yeah.
And obviously you have the opportunity as somebody who's coming in for a cup of coffee to pick up a CD while you're there, whereas you go into a record store, they're buried somewhere probably.
Yeah.
But I'm intrigued before we go listen to some more music from this set. How you see the internet and how you see downloading of music, and do you think that's something that you'll explore more further down the track?
Well, yeah, you know, I mean, what you have to look at is how people are doing it. You can't just say, I'm not going to support this because, you know, I think it's bad what you're doing, you know. I mean, if you think about it, you know, I go back so far. I'm in front of me. But that's an old lyric of mine. Don't worry about that. I'll get over it. But no, I go back to kind of, you know, vinyl and then tape cassettes and CDs and now downloading. So to me, it doesn't really matter. It's however people want to take the music. To me, it's the music that matters. You know, it's probably better if they listen to the vinyl. Well, how many people are going to do that these days? It's kind of inconvenient. It actually probably is the best sound. You know, if you're going to be a hi-fi nut, that's probably the best way to listen to it. But as I say, I don't care. It's up to people how they want to do it. So for me, it's just the music. However they want it delivered is up to them. So I'm kind of excited.
Do you ever see yourself, for example, releasing your own music through the internet and making songs available that perhaps you wouldn't put on records and letting people explore your library, I guess,
yeah.
Perhaps stuff that hasn't even been released?
Yeah. I think that's getting to be an interesting possibility, really. What you tend to do is we're doing a little bit of that anyway. You know, you'll give a free download of a mix you've had. I've got a really cool mix of one of the tracks on the album called Nod Your Head, the last track on the album, by Sly Dunbar. We're a nice little Jamaican mix. And that's kind of the place for that. You know, there's kind of people out there who DJs and stuff, and they want to mix with that stuff. So, yeah, that might really be, you know, a way forward. For me, it's just whatever's exciting. And that's what I like. You know, when I came into the music world, it was really exciting. This new release was going to be a bit boring. I was going to get a little bit bored with the old traditional methods, but we haven't done it that way. So this has been really exciting. You know, I'm playing an amoeba, for crying out loud. Yes. You know, it's like, I wouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
But it's great, you know, playing in a record shop, yeah.
Are you going to tour behind the record?
Yeah, not behind the record. No, I'm just doing some of these little gigs. Probably next year I'll tour.
Right.
But again, you know, I'm not doing it the traditional way. You know, this is just different. And I think that's cool.
Well, we're going to listen to a little bit more of the session that Paul and his band recorded at Amoeba. It's a real pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much.
Cheers.
And the album's out now. It's through Concord/Here, Starbucks. It's called Memory Almost Full. It's an interesting title. Why Memory Almost Full?
It came up on my phone. It's one of those things. It just said message memory almost full. And so I had to delete some stuff. You know, I had too many texts.
Right.
So I deleted some stuff and then it came up again. And I kept thinking, memory almost full, that's kind of cool. It means more than it thinks it does. So, you know, I just tried it on a few people. And they said, wow, cool title. And so I ended up doing it.
It's been great to meet you. Thanks so much.
Cool, man.
Cheers.
Nice to see you.
This is KCRW and Paul McCartney recorded live at Amoeba in Hollywood.
Singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life you were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn. This moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly, into the light of a dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. For this moment to rise, blackbird fly, blackbird fly, into the light of a dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. For this moment to be free, you were only waiting for this moment to be free. you were only waiting for this moment to be free.
Thank you.
Don't come to me for the whiplash.
Lightning hits the heart.
You're listening to a set of music recorded live at Amoeba Records in Hollywood with Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
Hey, Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to let her into your heart. Then you can start to make it better. Hey, Jude, don't be afraid. The minute you let her under your skin.
just the ladies, just the girls. Come on, girls. And the ladies again, you're so good, I like them.